today. I'll make it short. Anila is awesome, and brace yourself for more awesomeness.
I expect it. Good. So I'm the same Daniela as yesterday. And so yesterday, so with this brief introduction to the basics mathematics of lattices, but we didn't really do anything interesting or surprising. I mentioned some of the problems we'll talk about today, and that's what we'll do now. And so today, the whole day will be pretty much on average case complexity of lattice problems and applications to cryptography. And there are two problems that are used in cryptography that are related to lattices. One is the SIS, short integer solution problem. That's what I'll be talking about, and then later in the afternoon, Chris will talk about LWE, the learning with error problem. So what I want to cover today is a number of topics, which, so I will start with the definition of the problem. I already sketched it yesterday, but we'll go over the definition again connected to lattices, and then show that the problem is hard on the average, which is the hardness which is needed to build the cryptographic applications. I will not give a full proof. I condensed the proof on a single slide. By saying that it is pretty close, it has all the ideas of the proof. It has some technical inaccuracies, but other than that, I think it gives a very precise idea of why the problem is hard. And after that, we'll move into efficiency issues, what is required for lattice cryptography to be efficiently implemented. And the approach to efficient lattice cryptography is based on the use of a special class of lattices. So you will hear more about it later today. There will be two talks, one on the standard LWE problem, one on the efficient algebraic LWE problem. In the SIS setting, algebraic problem as a simpler treatment. So I will not talk a lot about it, but I will start introducing the ideas behind these efficient lattices in the SIS setting, which is much simpler. And then I will illustrate how this simple lattice problem can be used to build a number of representative cryptographic applications. And again, LWE has a much broader range of applications. It is an easier problem. So it is a stronger, so assume that LWE is hard, is a stronger hardness assumption. You can read, there are classical reductions from LWE to SIS, but the only way that we know how to reduce SIS to LWE is using quantum computers. So in some sense, there seems to be a gap between the two assumptions based on the current knowledge. Of course, showing that the two problems are perfectly equivalent, even in the classical setting, is a very interesting open problem. It might well be the case, but we don't know how to do it. Okay, so let's start with this SIS, or short integer solution problem. So let me first, before we get into the cryptographic definition, recall the geometry behind this problem, and this applies to LWE as well. So these are problems that are associated to CVP, the closest vector problem, where you are given a lattice represented by a basis and a target point T, and you want to find a lattice vector which is close to the target. So if you put a ball around the target, you can grow this ball until it includes a lattice point, and that's the closest one. Or equivalently, you can think of this target T as being the result of starting from a lattice point and then perturbing this lattice point with some error E, which is exactly the distance between T and the lattice. And so yesterday you learned everything about a dual lattice, so let's use it. So one way to formulate this problem, which is also quite close to the way the SIS problem is defined, is using the dual lattice. So this is the set of, if you remember, is the set of linear functions from the lattice to the integers. So dual vectors or the dual basis, a matrix that generates the dual lattice is a linear function from Rn to Rn, which when you apply it on a lattice point, it produces as a result an integer. But if you apply this function to an arbitrary target, then the result will not be an integer. And you can compute something that uniquely characterizes the position of the target T modulo the lattice by taking this linear product and reducing the result modulo 1. And so since the target is the sum of V with an error E, so this scalar product is linear, so you get D times V, which is an integer, and this appears modulo 1, plus the product D times the error, which using class standard coding terminology is called the syndrome of the error, because it is something that can be computed from the received word T, but it only depends on the error. It doesn't depend on the message, on the lattice point that was perturbed. Okay, so one way to think of this problem is, okay, you are given a shifted copy of the lattice that is all the lattice points that have, all the points in space that have a certain syndrome. So I give you the syndrome and I take all the possible points that map to it. And you want to find the point in this shifted copy of the lattice which is as short as possible. And that's perfectly equivalent to finding the lattice point which is closest to the target. So you can shift, so instead of considering a lattice center as zero and a target in an arbitrary position, you can always shift the lattice by the target position and then try to find a point in this shifted lattice which is as close as possible to the origin. To zero, so the shortest point in the coset. So this is called the syndrome decoding formulation of the problem. So, okay, so in this geometric setting, you can consider the following general function, where, so it is a function that is keyed by a lattice point, by a lattice, the green points in the picture. And the input is a vector x, which is short, is a bounded norm. So this is very pale, so I'm not sure if you can see it, but there is a shaded circle here around the origin. And what this function does is to take this short input vector and reduce it modulo the lattice. So this can be done either by multiplication by the dual matrix, or it can be done by picking a standard representative in a fundamental region of the lattice. And notice, if you increase the size of the error, these regions will start overlapping. So if the error is bounded by lambda 1 over 2, that's the unique decoding radius of the lattice, then you get an injective function. And that's the one that will correspond this afternoon to the LWE problem. But you can consider larger regions as where after reduction modulo the lattice, this sphere will have overlaps. So you see there are some darker regions here in the overlap. And at some point, it will cover the entire space, but not in a uniform manner. But at this point, once the radius equals the covering radius of the lattice, you have a surjective function from the ball of short vectors to the fundamental parallel biped. And most typically in cryptography, you increase this radius even more beyond that, so that the resulting function is not only surjective, but it is almost regular. It produces an almost uniform distribution after you take a short vector and you reduce it modulo the lattice. So SIS corresponds basically to this last setting, while LWE is this function when the error is small enough to make the function injective. So the question is, are these functions hard to invert? Are they cryptographically strong one-way functions?
Yeah.
In
think about the ball as being sort of fixed and the lattice is either a dense lattice or a sparse lattice for SIS versus LWE, right?
But no. No, the lattice is the key to the function. The lattice is fixed. So it is a family of functions. It's not a fixed function, but it's a function family. And by picking the lattice, you are choosing a key.
So we think about the SIS lattice, it's a very dense lattice, right, typically. It's the kernel of,
Okay. Yeah. In terms of density, yes. Yeah. So if you normalize, you can all, instead of it growing the size of the input, you can also normalize the size. You say, the input has length square root of n. It's a binary vector. And then you can take a lattice that has a larger or smaller determinant.
These are not just morally equivalent, they're actually equivalent, you're saying.
If you restrict it to integer vectors, of course, you cannot scale by arbitrary factors. But other than that, yes. So in this setting, which is geometric, there is no... So here I'm basically illustrating the problem as an instance of the bounded distance decoding problem or the absolute distance decoding problem that we defined yesterday. And in the real setting, you can just scale it. You can always normalize the determinant of the lattice to 1. That's easy. In the cryptographic setting, you typically, in applications, you want to work with integer vectors, but not because of the hardness, just because they are easier to implement. For efficiency, practical efficiency reasons. And there are a few cases where integers come up in a more substantial way. But for the standard SIS and LWE problems, morally, you can think of these two things equivalent as using a larger input or a larger, smaller, denser lattice.
In fact, the first version with real errors, not integer ones.
Yeah, but the lattice is still an integer lattice. You still cannot scale it arbitrarily. And it is perhaps a little bit counterintuitive that SIS, is, which I have here, is usually defined with binary errors, while LWE is defined with errors. It doesn't have to be. But in the most common instantiation, in SIS, you say that, and the error is a vector with binary components. In LWE, you want a vector where components are at least a square root of n. So at first, it may seem that LWE is using longer error vectors than SIS. But that's just, if you compare it to the determinant of the lattice, it's exactly the opposite, the situation. And in LWE, you need the errors to be at least a square root of n size for some other technical reasons. But then you can compensate for it by setting the dimension and the determinant of the lattice appropriately. Okay, yes?
So the hard problem here is so once you shift or reduce it with the lattice, basically, there is one corner of this hypercube-like structure, this parallel bit, and the hard thing is to figure out which is the closest corner.
It's not necessarily a corner. If it were a corner, then it would be a much easier problem. So the lattice point closest to a target inside the parallelepiped may be a lattice point that is somewhere else. In this case, it is not the case. So this is a fairly nice basis for the lattice, which is almost orthogonal. So yes, most likely it is always a corner of the parallelepiped. But if I give a very skewed basis for the lattice, and then I give a point in the middle of this skewed parallelepiped, then the closest lattice point is likely to belong to some other parallelepiped that doesn't even touch the one that you are using as a fundamental region. Yes.
So what do you mean by inverting? Is like finding a preimage or specific?
Finding a short preimage, so finding a point that is congruent to the target, but it is short. Now, the picture is a bit misleading in the sense that the vectors here, they look shorter as those there. But that's just because, in two dimensions, and if you want the picture to be readable, there is not much you can do. But yes, it is considering all the shifted copy of the lattice centered around a target in here, and of all these points, find the closest to the origin, which typically is not the one inside the parallelepiped, but it is something else. So this to put this in the sort of geometric context of general lattices that I described yesterday. So in cryptography, the problem is usually formulated in a much simpler, elementary way that involves only integers. And the ITIE SIS function, SIS is the short integer solution problem, and the name comes from this formulation, is defined as follows. So the problem is parameterized by some integers, two dimensions, n and m, and a modulus, q. And this is a function family that is keyed by a matrix A, which is an n by m matrix with entries which are integers modulo q. And this matrix is chosen uniformly at random. Okay. And you can think of it as defining a random QRE lattice, a random lattice which is periodic modulo q. Yesterday we saw two different ways to define a lattice. From A, you can either take the image of the rows or the kernel. And we'll see that the kernel is the one that is most relevant in this setting. And the function is very, very simple. In fact, it is just a linear function that takes an input vector x and outputs a times x modulo q. Now, this function for arbitrary inputs is very easy to invert. You can find a preimage just solving a system of linear equations. Solution is not unique. You will find some solution. And what makes the problem hard is that the function is defined as having, as a domain, a set of small vectors. So for concreteness, here I'm using 0, 1 to the m, so vectors with binary entries. But what it matters is just that these vectors are short. You can generalize it to other sets or vectors that have a bounded Euclidean length. And once you do that, using linear algebra, you will be able to find a preimage of the target, but it will not be a short one in general. You will typically find a preimage which is not short at all. You will find a long one. So it is not in the domain, so that's not solving the inversion problem. And the function is computed modulo q. A is a matrix modulo q, so everything is reduced modulo q. Now, in the discussion of dual lattices yesterday, you may remember that the kernel and the image of A, they are related by duality up to a scaling factor q. So reduction modulo q here corresponds to reduction modulo 1 in my previous geometric description of this function. So here everything is done using integers, which allow for easier implementation. So what do we know about this function? So we know that the function is hard in a very interesting sense. This was the result that somehow marks the birth of lattice-based cryptography, the use of lattices for the design of secure constructions. So ITIE proved that if the dimension m, n, and q satisfies a certain relation, in particular if m is big enough, then this function is one way. It is hard to invert, assuming that lattice problems, in particular the SIVP problem, the short integer solution, the shortest independent vector problem, is hard at all in the worst case, to approximate within some factor. So we'll go back to it in a bit. But for now, just to get a sense of this problem, so here is a specific instance. It's a small one. It's something that with a computer you could solve right away. And just pretend I didn't give out the solution here to start. Okay, no, this one is not a solution. So this one is just an input. So the matrix is a 4 by 6 by 7 matrix here. We are performing the arithmetic modulo q, so all the numbers are single digits. You can multiply a by this vector x, which is a binary vector. You get this as an output, assuming I didn't do any errors. Now, if I were to hide this and I ask you, can you find a 0, 1 solution to this problem? Could you do it right away? Doesn't look easy, and in fact it's something that is reminiscent of the it's a subset sum problem. So it's a problem, it's a notoriously NP-hard problem. Subset sum usually is defined over integers. Here we are performing a subset sum over vectors. So we have a good sense that, we don't expect that finding 0-1 solutions to be easy as finding arbitrary integer solutions. And so this problem, inverting the function, is exactly the cryptanalysis problem that corresponds to inverting this as a one-way function. So we'll see other notions of hardness for this function. We'll see soon that the function is not only one-way, not only it is hard to find a binary preimage, it is also hard to find collisions. Now, even if we are restricting the domain to a set of binary vectors, so if you remember here we had a condition that m was bigger than n log q. So that means that the set of binary vectors that you can pass as input is bigger than the set of possible outputs. So you have q to the n possible outputs because the output is a vector modulo q with n coordinates. And you have 2 to the m possible inputs, the set of all possible binary vectors. So this function is never injective. So it has a bigger domain than a range. There exist collisions. There are points that map to the same output, but those points will be hard to find. So what is the connection between this description and the geometric description of the function that I gave before? This point you can probably see it already on your own, but let's review it together. So you are given this function that is not mentioning lattices explicitly. It's just a matrix vector multiplication restricted to binary inputs. So where do lattices come up? So it can be formulated as a lattice problem as follows. I'm illustrating the connection to lattices as a possible way to solve the problem. So how can you solve this inversion problem? You can first solve the easy problem of finding an arbitrary preimage. AT equals Y, where T is not required to be short. T is not 0, 1. So this one, everybody can do it. Just a linear algebra and Gaussian elimination, especially if Q is a prime, is particularly simple. You're over a field, and you can just use standard Gaussian elimination. So, but this one doesn't solve the inversion problem. It's easy to find, but it's not a solution. But once you find it, you know, just from linear algebra, that all the solutions to the system of equations AX equal Y, modulo Q, are the sum of this specific solution that you just found together with a solution to the corresponding homogeneous system. And this the homogeneous system is exactly the kernel of the matrix A. It's the set of vectors, X, integer vectors, such that AX equals 0, modulo Q. So you want to find a binary vector, or more generally, a short vector in a shifted copy of this integer lattice, which is exactly the Coset formulation of the closest vector problem that we described before in the general geometric setting by drawing a picture. So there is no picture here, it's just equations, matrices, and vectors, which often is the most convenient way to work on these things to design new cryptographic functions, to implement them, to produce pseudocode or code, and even to carry out proofs. But you can draw a picture behind that correspond to these problems, which I think at first is very useful to get a good intuitive sense of what is the problem being solved. Because geometry, in the end, plays a very important role in pretty much all the algorithms or most algorithms that are used to solve these problems, even when restricted to binary input vectors. So, so this is the SIS problem, the definition. And with this connection, you see how the SIS problem, this short integer solution problem, the problem of finding a short solution to a system of linear equations modulo Q, is an average case version of the closest vector problem. It is an instance of the closest vector problem, or the closed, it's not necessarily the closest. It's approximate closest or generally closed vector problem, or more technically, it is actually this absolute distance decoding where you want to find a vector within a certain bound. The bound is the binary cube in this case. And but instantiated with a specific distribution on the class of lattices. These are the lattices which are generated by picking a uniformly random matrix A. So this defines the probability distribution on these kernels, on these integer lattices, and also a distribution on how the target is chosen. It is chosen by picking a random binary input vector and then applying the function to it. So this establishes a first connection between these two problems.
So close here doesn't mean sort of close in any norm, really. Not because you would get minus one, zero, one vectors.
Yes, okay. So in order to think of this as close, instead of 0, 1, you want to take 0, 1, minus 1, okay? So which is just as fine. And that's what I have here. In fact, so I'm using 0, 1 because it makes it easier to illustrate the connection with collision resistance. But yes.
Second question is, if you change the domain from 0, 1 to the end, to vectors of norm much less than square root m. Mm-hmm. And square root m is the smoothing product. Then, you know, you don't have a surjective function anymore. And do you think that this function is equivalent to LWE? This function is hard to invert, you're saying.
Inverting this function is exactly LWE, but written differently, using via duality. Using where the function is implemented using the dual basis rather than the primal basis. But other than that, syntactically, SIS and LWE are equivalent via duality, are equivalent formulations of the same class of problems. The real difference between SIS and LWE is not that LWE is using AS plus error while area, is that the error relative to the determinant is different. But yes, if you take the density
of the lattice, if you write both of them as the same form, A times C equals that,
yeah.
The density of the lattice is different in both cases, right? So here the lattice is very dense. It has like tons of short vectors, the way it's written down.
Yes.
And in the LWE case, the lattice is much sparser. You have the same error length as square root m.
If you prefer, you can scale that. But yeah, if you fix the lattice, if you scale it so that the lattice is the same and what is different is the length of the error, is, so then,
Yes? Here, Q can be arbitrary or should it be prime?
Doesn't have to be prime. It is pretty much arbitrary. The factorization of Q, it hardly plays any role in determining the complexity of the problem. But we will see soon that you want Q to be large enough. For example, if you were to take Q equal to 2 in the extreme case, and then say that, I want vectors which are short in the Hamming metric. Of course, 0, 1 vectors is the entire space, modulo 2. So this is the learning parity with noise problem. So it's a classic problem in the theory of linear codes and machine learning. And we do not know how to prove harness, the type of harness that is proved for lattices. Proving the type of harness for Q equal 2 is challenging. And there is some kind of harness that can be proved. But yeah, typically you want Q to be at least n. I'll talk later about how small can you reduce Q and still have the type of harness that I will show. Okay? But other than that, the Q is an arbitrary integer, and it is not a large integer. So it is an integer with only logarithmically many bits. Typical values of Q that are used, that can be used in practice, can be as small as 256. If you want a prime, there are some cryptographic functions using Q equal to 257, which is a prime. It has also some other nice properties. And numbers are essentially a single byte. So it's a small arbitrary integers. Primality of Q sometimes is convenient to make certain operations faster to implement in practice, because you can use, it's nicer to work in finite fields.
Okay.
So collision resistance. So this function not only is one way, but it is also collision resistant. And in fact, it is possible to show that collision resistance follows for free. It follows from the fact that it is one way, provided that you slightly change the domain of the function. Consider the following problems. So we know that this is a lattice, this kernel, and a collision to the function corresponding to A is a pair of distinct vectors x and y such that ax equals ay modulo q. Now, if you take the difference between these two vectors, ax and y are two distinct binary vectors. So their difference will be a non-zero vector with coordinates which are 0, 1, or minus 1. So it is still a vector with coordinates which are bounded by 1 in absolute value. So it is a short vector. And just by linearity, if you apply the function a to z, to the difference, you get exactly ax minus ay, which is 0, because that's a collision. Those two values are the same. So finding a short vector in this kernel corresponds to finding a collision to the function. In this case, we have, so you can just talk about norm. You care about the length of the vector. So if here, instead of taking 0, 1 vectors, you take vectors in a certain ball, collisions will give you vectors in a ball which is slightly larger, because the when you take the difference, it gets a little bit longer. And, so I'm using 0, 1 again, because in practice, those are the easier to implement. You want to pick an input to the function at random. In practice, it is much easier to pick a random binary vector than picking a vector in a ball, which requires some, still can be done, but certainly is not as straightforward as picking a sequence of bits. But this is just for convenience of implementation, as not much to do, if anything at all, with the security and hardness of the function. And for binary vectors, the problem is that of finding an input that has infinity norm equal to 1. So it should be non-zero. It's easy to find. 0 is always mapped to 0 by the function. You want to find something that is non-zero. Now, this shows how this SIS inversion or collision finding problem can be interpreted as an average case lattice problem, as an instance of a special case of the closed vector problem on a certain random class of lattices. But there is a much deeper connection than that. So this is the intuitive connection showing that, if you can solve the lattice problem, then you can break the function. But there is something much deeper that can be shown. And this is the second topic of today's talk, which is average case hardness. So in cryptography, you want functions to be hard to solve on the average, so that when you pick your key at random, then you know that your key is hard to break. You don't care that, there exists some key that is hard to break. No adversary can break every single key. So that's something that you want when working on algorithms. You want your algorithm to work for any instance of your problem. You give the graph, you find the shortest path. You don't want the algorithm to say, you gave me a hard distance of the shortest path problem. You want to solve all of them. An algorithm that works is an algorithm that works all the time. A cryptographic function, which is hard, is a function that should be hard to solve, if not all the times, at least most of the times, with very high probability. So average case hardness is really the essence of cryptography. And we want to show that the previous connection between SIS and lattices pretty much said that if you can solve the lattice problems, then you can solve SIS, because it is a specific average case instance of the lattice problem. So we want to do something that goes in the other direction. We want to show that the only way to solve SIS is to solve a lattice problem. So we want to give a reduction from lattice problems to SIS, which is the standard methodology in modern cryptography to gain confidence in the hardness of a function. And that's what is done typically in also number theoretic constructions. So consider, for example, Rabin's function, which is a square in modulo a large integer, which is the product of two primes. So the product of two primes, n, is the key to the function. And it is a well-known result that being able to extract the square roots modulo n is equivalent to factoring n, which we believe is a hard problem. So you can say that inverting the function is at least as hard as factoring. And notice, in this connection, there is a one-to-one correspondence between function keys, numbers to be factored, and function keys, and function on the other side. So if you assume that this problem, factoring n, is hard for most numbers n, or at least for most numbers n chosen according to this distribution, product of two large primes, then you get that this function is hard to invert for most keys. So there's a one-to-one correspondence. And what we showed for lattices is something, so far, is something that is similar to this. So we have a class of lattices, which are chosen at random, a corresponding class of functions, and each function corresponds to a lattice. And if solving the shortest vector problem in the infinity norm, say in these lattices, is hard on average for most lattices, then this is a one-way function. It's a function which is hard to break for most keys. So, but that's not quite enough to. So, how do we know that these problems are hard? How do we know that this is the right class of lattices to use, the right distribution, a good way to pick lattices at random? Because, after all, average case hardness depends on the distribution. Consider the factoring problem. So, I give you the. So, factoring, you're given a number n, and you want to factor it into the product of two integers bigger than one, a times b. So is this problem hard on average without quantum computing? I know that there are there's a good number of quantum computing people in the audience. You're not allowed to use your pocket quantum computer, your Q-phone. And so we'll... it depends on the distribution, even with classical computers, even with a pencil. If I pick a uniformly random integer, 50% of the time is even. And you can immediately factor it as 2 times n over 2. Okay? So the fact that factoring in the classical setting is believed to be hard is something that is specific to a certain distribution. So, and this one is not a good one, choosing n uniformly at random. So how do we know that choosing a uniformly random a is a good way to pick a lattice at random that results in average case hardness? It could be the case that, similarly to integer, if you pick a uniformly at random, then there is some trivial, straightforward way to do it. So that A is an easy lattice, and the corresponding function is not one way for that key. So in order to address this issue, we need a different type of reduction, which is randomized. And given any lattice as a starting point, it can map that lattice not just to a single function, but it can randomly map to an arbitrary function. So any lattice can be mapped in principle to any function, to any matrix A, and this is done in a random way. So assume we have such a reduction. So this reduction is somehow forgetting which lattice you started from. No matter which lattice you started from, it produces a uniformly random matrix A. Now assume that this function is not one way, meaning that there is a small set of keys for which your attack works, which can be broken. Okay? Maybe this could be still hard most of the times, but assume that a fraction of keys, the white circle here, where your attack works is non-negligible. So if you start, if you are given an arbitrary lattice L and you apply the reduction, you will get typically a function where the attack doesn't work. But if the attack doesn't work, then you can just run the reduction again, and you will get a different matrix A. And then you will get another one. And you keep performing the attack, the reduction with different randomness, until hopefully you map L to one of the easy instances. And once you do that, you can break the cryptographic function and solve the corresponding lattice problem.
Okay.
So unless you solve, unless you can solve the lattice problem for every lattice, assume, I mean, there's no technical definition for it, but let's say that L is the hardest lattice in the world.
Okay.
So you manage to find the hardest possible lattice for CVP. That's the specific lattice that you wanted to solve. Yes, so if you want to know what it looks like, Leo will show you after the talk. And so you can solve CVP on that specific lattice by mapping it over and over again to a random matrix A until you hit an easy instance of the function. Okay? So if you assume that hard lattices exist at all, there exists at least one lattice where CVP is hard, then this fraction of easy instances of SIS must be negligible, must be so small that you will... It will take a very long time. It will take forever before you hit a point that is in there. Okay. So that's the type of reduction that we want to give. And this is what ITAI did in 96 and brought lattices under the spotlight of problems that can be used for cryptography. And there's been a number of refinements and improvements on ITAI's reduction, the reduction by Oded Regev and myself in 2004 was is close to the pretty much the best reduction. There have been some further refinement after that. Vinod and Chris had some further refinements that using the discrete Gaussian sampling improved the modulus Q that is used in the reduction. But it is the core of the result. And it says that if SIVP is hard to solve approximately within a factor n, linear in the dimension. So this is the factor, ITAI had a much bigger polynomial factor. So this work is the one that managed to bring the approximation factor to n, to which is still today the smallest polynomial known to give this type of hardness. So assuming that this problem is hard in the worst case for some lattice, then the function f is one way, and it is also collision resistant.
Okay,
so how do we do that? How can we perform such type of reduction? So from the picture, you see that the reduction should, in some sense, forget which lattice point you started from. So I give you a lattice, you give me a uniformly random A. I give you another lattice, you still give me a uniformly random A. So no matter which lattice you start from, the reduction should somehow clear this lattice, make it disappear. Shouldn't disappear completely, because otherwise the reduction would be, you cannot just pick a uniformly random A from scratch. So this matrix A should still somehow convey useful information about L, but should have a distribution which is independent of L. And this can be done using the idea of smoothing a lattice, or blurring a lattice, and that's where the smoothing parameter that I defined yesterday comes up. So remember, so given a lattice, you can start adding noise to your lattice. And the noise at first gives these joint spheres. As the noise gets larger, the spheres will start overlapping. At some point, they will cover the entire space. And and notice, the moment that these spheres cover the entire space, every point in space, a point in Rn, can be written as the sum of two vectors, V and R, where V is a lattice point and R is a short vector. Now, how short? Well, within the covering radius of the lattice, which we know is at most square root of n lambda n. So this gives a way to represent every point in space as the sum of a lattice point and a short vector. And of course, this decomposition depends on the lattice. But the final result is an arbitrary point in Rn. And the function use even larger noise, which produces a distribution which is close to uniform in space. But still, you can represent every point in space as the sum of an error vector together with a small perturbation. And if you take this vector A, so you can go in the other direction. You can first start from a vector V, add an error R to it, and then you reduce the result, modulo the lattice. This should be close to the uniform distribution over the fundamental region of the lattice. So we mapped a point in space to a uniform vector in a parallelepiped, in a way that depends on the lattice, but the output distribution is uniform, regardless of which lattice you started from. If you are using a point in the fundamental region, of course, the shape of the fundamental region depends on the lattice. But think of it as just as a point in 0, 1 to the n. So the geometric shape of the region doesn't matter. We just look at the coordinates of the point with respect to the lattice basis.
The torus.
Yes, it is a torus. And if you... if you use the dual lattice formulation, it is multiplication by D, so it is a vector with coordinates between 0 and 1. So on a torus, typically, you also consider the geometry of the torus. So here, we don't care about it. We just care about the fact that it's uniform. So that you can apply linear transformation, and it doesn't matter. What it matters is that the original point can be written as a sum in this way. So why is this good? Well, you can already see that if the idea was to forget which lattice you started from, in some sense, we achieved it. So another way to describe what's happening here is that is saying that all lattices, if you look them from far enough, they all look the same. They all look like a dense. Once you look at them from far away, the points will be very close to each other. Can you see the pixels in this screen? I can from here, but perhaps from back there, you don't really see the projection here. You cannot see the fine structure of the dot matrix. It looks like a continuous space. So if I tell you that, these are hexagonal pixels, you cannot tell if you are far enough. And so GPV, so this is a work of Vinod, Chris, and Craig. What he did was, instead of using Rn, it used a discrete set, lambda divided by q, which is a number of nice properties. I will not get to this level of detail, so I will use real numbers. So SIS is an integer problem. It is enough to describe the idea. So real numbers are enough to describe the ideas behind the reduction. For the reduction to be technically sound, you do need to somehow use a discrete subset of Rn. But it is a much finer grid where you take your lattice and you divide it by a large integer. So intuitively, you can think of it as a continuous space. So how is this used? So we know that these points, so you can generate these points by first picking a random lattice point, picking a random error of this length and adding them up, or if you like, first picking the random error, reducing the modulo the lattice, and then computing V as the closest point to the reduced error. So you sample these values, and you know that this A will be uniformly random. So it is a way to sample uniformly random values A's, but knowing that they can be written as a sum in this manner. And if we ignore the fact that these are real vectors in my sketch, think of them as integer vectors in a fine grid. You can use them as columns of a matrix A. And since each one of them is distributed uniformly at random in this cube, in the unit cube, this will be a uniformly random matrix. And you can think of it as a key to SIS. if you are working modulo Q, this if you are scaling the lattice modulo Q, instead of being a, instead of being vectors in the unit cube, it will be vectors in ZQ to the n. And that's where the arithmetic modulo Q comes up. And you can pick as many columns as you want in this matrix. So the dimension of the lattice is the number of rows of the matrix, while the number of columns is something that you can choose any way you want. So you can pick the number of columns large enough so that this function is surjective. At which point is a good SIS matrix. You can pass it to an oracle that supposedly finds collisions, finds solutions to the SIS problem, get a solution, and then what does this solution tell us about the original lattice problem that we wanted to solve? So we started from a lattice L, which is not even a QRE lattice. It's an arbitrary lattice in Euclidean space. We used that lattice to pick vectors modulo Q in the discrete setting with uniform distribution, but in a way that geometrically is related to the lattice that we started from, because every column of A can be written as the sum of a lattice vector in our worst case lattice plus a small perturbation. Okay, now a hypothetical attacker finds a collision to the function and says, oh, I can find a 0, 1, minus 1 vector such that this sum is equal to 0. Okay, so this is a proof for contradiction. We're assuming that an attacker can find the collision. And now, using this collision, I want to show you that I can solve the original SIVP problem in the lattice that we started from, which has nothing to do with the kernel of A. So the kernel of A is just the kernel of a random matrix modulo Q. And there is this lattice L that we started from that got somehow hidden in it in a way that cannot even be detected by the attacker. The attacker is given a uniformly random matrix A, and it doesn't know that it was picked using this specific process. But we know that. So after the attacker comes up with a collision, we can use this side information that we have from the way we picked the random matrix A. So we know that each of these vectors, AI, is the sum of a lattice vector V plus a small perturbation, R. Okay? So let's just rewrite this differently. Let's bring all the Vs on one side and all the Rs on the other side. So we know that this sum is equal to 0 because this is a collision. So you get that the sum of Vi Zi is equal to negative sum of Ri Zi. I'm just writing this equation, this sum is equal to 0, as the equality between two vectors. And we know that Z is a short integer vector. It's a collision. It's a short non-zero integer vector. So we know that these two vectors are the same. They are the same vectors. And each one of them tells us something interesting. The equation here on the left tell us that this vector is a lattice point because it is an integer combination of lattice vectors. Zi's are integers, Vi's are in the lattice, so this is a point in the lattice. And what else do we know? Well, we know that this vector can also be written in this way. And this is a combination of short vectors, Ri, which are not in the lattice, but they are short, and they are combined with short coefficients. Zi is a small vector, so the coordinates of Zi are small. So here we don't care, we don't know if it's in the lattice or not, but we know that it is short. But since these two quantities are the same, this vector is simultaneously short and it belongs to the lattice. So we found a short lattice vector. So we did it. Okay, so that's the idea of the proof. So there are various technicalities that I omitted. One is that at first I was using real numbers, so you needed to make this more precise using a fine grid. So here there's a chance that even if Z is a non-zero vector, or perhaps after you add all these vectors, then the sum is zero, which is short. It belongs to the lattice, but it doesn't solve SVP. But there is enough information that is hidden in this process that you can show that even an all-powerful adversary will not be able to do that. And that's why you need a function which is not injective. If the function were injective, then that would be the only way to get zero as a result, to get the zero vector. Here there are different vectors that map to the same point. The adversary doesn't know which is the one that we will be able to reconstruct, so the one that we will be able to reconstruct is going to be non-zero with high probability. Okay, so this concludes the proof or proof sketch that the SIS problem is hard on average. Okay, so let's get now to efficiency and then cryptographic applications. So efficiency, I'll just give some elements just to tell you what are the type of things that come up when you want to use these problems. And I will first briefly tell you about the choice of the modulus, which is, I think, a technically interesting problem, because in principle, we would like these problems to be hard even when Q is as small as 2, but we don't know how to prove that. So this is one of the main open problems in the area. So how small can we make Q for this to work? Some constructions even use very large Qs, and sometimes using very, very large Q makes things easier, but it's a harder assumption. So the smaller Q is, the easier is the problem. So we would like Q to be small. And small Q is also useful for efficiency. It means that you can implement your functions using a small number arithmetic. You don't need the long precision integer arithmetic used in the implementation of factoring-based, discrete log, or other number theoretic constructions. So Itai, in the original proof, was showing that Q, if Q is an arbitrary polynomial sufficiently large, then the function is one way. And in fact, this Q was arbitrarily large. So depending on the probability of the adversary breaking the function A, then you needed a larger larger Q. So this Q, there was not even a constant bound on the exponent. But then this was brought down in a sequence of paper, first, I think, to 16. He said, oh, you can set Q to be just n to the power 16, and then this was improved in a sequence of papers. The paper I mentioned before brought the modulus Q down to a small power of n to the power 2.5, and this is what in 2008 was improved to be just linear in the dimension. And using a smaller Q is something that is not easy to show that when you formalize the proof sketch that I showed you before and to make it into a real proof, you will see that a larger Q allows to take vectors and make them shorter. If Q is not large enough, you will not be able to get these short vectors. So one question at this point is the problem hard if you take Q smaller than n? N, after all, is the dimension of the worst-case lattice. So it could be a sort of natural bound below which maybe the function becomes computationally different. Okay. But so in 2013, Chris, myself, showed that you can actually make it smaller. You can bring the modulus down to as close as you want to square root of n. The function does not necessarily get more efficient because as we do that, we need to increase the dimension of the function. But there is no conceptual reason to believe that Q has to be at least n. So we don't know now how to go below square root of n, but we know it is possible. Yeah, so n is not the answer. And let me tell you how the proof works. It's a simple combinatorial proof that works by reducing SIS to itself. So assume, for simplicity, that the input is binary. And the proof can be generalized to short vectors, but I'll make explicit use of binary vectors that make things much simpler. And assume that we can solve SIS for some values of n, m, and q with probability 1. And that's why I call this a toy version of the reduction. You want a reduction that is robust and works even for attackers that work with small probability. Now, how can you use that to solve SIS with a bigger modulus? By using also a bigger dimension m. Notice, as the modulus gets larger, the range of the function gets larger. So for the functions to still be to still be surjective, you also needed to increase the size of the domain. So the fact that we are increasing both M and Q makes sense. But is there,
The surjectivity is sufficient to make it 2M instead of M squared, but Q
For the proof to work, yes. And that's why the final result, from a practical efficiency point of view, you might be better off using the larger Q. And so we do this. We take this larger matrix and we break it into M blocks, each with M coordinates. And each of these matrix is a matrix modulo Q square. But you can think of these numbers modulo Q squares as two-digit numbers in the base Q. So each of these matrices can be written as a matrix A1 prime modulo Q plus another matrix, A1 double prime modulo Q, scaled up by a factor of Q. So these are the two digits in base Q of your matrix. You split them, so they become two different matrices modulo Q. So now each of these matrices now is a good instance to the original SIS problem. And the parameters are chosen in such a way, there are collisions. So you can try to find 0-1 collisions to each of these matrices modulo Q. A1 prime, A2 prime, and so on. So you find 0-1 plus minus 1 vectors such that this product is equal to 0 modulo Q. And so this involves solving M instances of this SIS problem, but assume that we can do that with probability 1, so we solve all of them. And after you do that, we can subtract this matrix from this one, and we get Q times A1 double prime, which is a multiple of Q, so we can divide it by Q. So we can take AI prime plus QA double prime times Q. When we multiply this by Z, the first part goes to 0. The second part is a multiple of Q, so we can divide this by Q. So let's call these values B. We have one, we are mapping each of these blocks to a single vector by multiplying it, each one of them, by a small collision. We find a collision here and we get a vector. We get a vector which is 0 modulo Q, but it is not 0 modulo Q square. But we get all these vectors, which are multiples of Q. We divide them by Q. Now we have M vectors modulo Q, and we combine them into one last SIS instance, and we find a collision to this instance. So we take a 0, 1, minus 1 combination of these vectors. So this is a 0, 1, minus 1 combination of 0, 1, minus 1 combinations of the original vectors. And that's why I'm restricting to 0 to 1. It is still a 0, 1, minus 1 combination of the original vectors. It is non-zero. And we found a solution to the original problem. So the solution is precisely some kind of a tensor product between the last collision that we found and the M collisions that we found in the previous step.
The reason this doesn't extend beyond 2, QQ.
Yeah. So all the details that I'm omitting here, they show. So in fact, if you do this, you said it seems like that. Oh, you can always increase the Q. So if you can use a larger Q, then you can do the smaller one. In principle, you can go from 2 to 2 to the n. No, it doesn't work. But yeah, so if you read the paper, it will be apparent why. Yeah, it doesn't. In fact, square root of n is where the reduction. So we cannot go below square root of n. So if you fix all the technical details in the reduction, then you need Q to be at least the square root of n.
The square root of n somehow natural because the vectors are of norm square root.
Yes. Yeah, it is relative to the
norm of the vectors, but
I don't have a good intuition of why. Yeah, and we cannot achieve square root of n. We can get n to the power 1/2 plus epsilon. We cannot even get to square root of n. And it's a good open problem, yeah. So it's a kind of technical question. So it's not a question that people really, you know, tried really, really hard to address, but getting either a good theoretical explanation of why square root of n is a barrier for the modulus q would be useful. Breaking the barrier and go below square root of n would also be very useful. And before this result, n was considered the natural barrier. Okay, so it is not possible to go below n. That's why the binary case is hard. And yeah, maybe the binary case is still hard, but now the barrier is square root of n. And yeah, maybe you can get to fourth root of n or something else. So the actual proof is using discrete Gaussian sampling. It is giving a reduction from discrete Gaussian sampling to itself. So there are many more technicalities, but it's not a hard, comparatively to other lattice papers, is a fairly simple and self-contained reduction, because everything is average case. There is no worst case to average case connection. Everything is SIS to SIS reduction that we are doing.
There's no reason there should be n squared here, right? Isn't it trivial?
No, I'm not. I'm hiding what. Yeah.
You can actually do m, not 2m, for that matter, right?
Oh yeah. Here I was using m so that you, once you break it into blocks, yeah. So that all the calls to SIS have dimension m. Yeah. Fixed many things that are done more generally in the paper and yeah on the front yes yeah.
Also in the paper you have like if you have a bounded L2 norm then you can do better right it's not just an infinity norm but also a bounded L2 norm don't you have you can go below square root n or am I misremembering?
Our main goal was to reduce Q, and we couldn't go below square root of n, so I'm not saying that it cannot be done, but please do it. And I encourage you and everybody to do it. But yeah, if you do it, it's something that with Chris and I tried to do, and we couldn't find a way to a straightforward way to do it. So, maybe there is a straightforward way to do it, and I'll be happy to see.
So then I was saying something rather trivial. Maybe I'm mistaken. So if you can break the n by 2m version, you can break the n by n squared version, right? Because intuitively.
Honestly, I don't even remember exactly. Yeah. So
you have this M squared matrix. Just drop all columns except 2M. Give it to the guy.
No, but there are no collisions modulo Q squared.
Modulo 2M. All M needs to be is bigger than n log Q squared, which is 2N log. Yeah. So then there are collisions. The guy will find you, and then that's good. You're good.
Yeah, but it doesn't. I don't think it gives you what you want.
Why.
But anyway, there are many details which are hidden under the rug, and honestly, I don't have all those details fresh in my mind. But I would be surprised if there is a completely trivial reduction that allows to reduce the modulus Q and
not reduce the modulus Q, but reduce the m squared to m. That's all I mean.
But you don't care about m. In some sense, m doesn't. M can be anything. In the worst case, to average case reduction, the number of columns can be anything you want. So it is reducing Q. What the goal is here is to find a way to reduce the modulus Q.
But the function at the end, you don't want to set M to be like M squared.
Oh yeah. You can do it. Oh yeah, definitely. Yes. You don't need. So the reason I went all the way to M squared is just to give a simple thing. In fact, even adapting this from something that works when you can find collisions with probability 1 to finding a more robust reduction, it introduces a number of complications that make the actual reduction in the paper look quite a bit different from this. So this is only for the, to give an idea of how these type of things can be. So there is another efficiency issue that I'll. So this one I will just go through this. What time? I started at 10, so I don't know. I have 20 minutes left, correct? Okay, so let me just go through this skip it almost. But just mention at least a more substantial important issue related to efficiency is the following. So, okay, you can instantiate this function with fairly small numbers. So there are even some instantiation where Q is, say, 2 to the 8, 8-bit number, single byte, the dimension is 64. So you get a function that is mapping 1,000 bits to 500 bits. And we don't know how to break it in practice. It seems to have a good hardness properties. The numbers, they look small. But once you put all these numbers together, what is the size of the key? What is the size of this number? You have n squared times log n. So these functions, even for the simplest possible instantiations, they have fairly large keys. And they require a time, a computation time, which is proportional at very least to the size of the key. So they are not that good from an efficiency point of view. They are polynomial time, but the complexity of computing these functions, which are matrix functions, grows quadratically with the dimension. So can we get, so in practice, we would like something that is linear in the dimension rather than quadratic. The dimension captures the security level of the function. It's the dimension of the lattice, so it is the main security parameter in cryptography. So the idea that can be used here is the following. So instead of using an arbitrary matrix, A, use a matrix that has some kind of structure, for example, a circular matrix, a matrix where every row or every column is obtained by taking the previous one and rotating cyclically its coordinates. So this allows to represent each of these matrix blocks using only n coordinates, and the other are implicitly represented by a single vector. And so this was proposed as a one-way function in a paper of mine back in 2002, and it was using a class of matrices that is closely related, very similar to the one used by the N-true crypto system, which had been proposed a few years before. But there was just a concrete proposal to perform encryption. The focus of my paper was try to prove something about it, try to give some kind of evidence that these functions are hard. And one may, you can still apply the average case to average case reduction in the sense that, this is still a lattice problem. If these lattice problems are hard on average, then the corresponding function is hard to invert on average, and it is efficient. So wishful thinking say that, okay, so maybe everything works fine also here, and we get a more practical, perhaps heuristic instantiation. So let's consider a specific instance. This is using dimension 4, so it should be fairly easy. So let's see what happens. So you see these are circular blocks, and a modulo 10. And you want to find a collision. You want to find a 0, 1, minus 1 combination of these columns that adapts to 0. Here, there is an input vector which does not adapt to 0. You want to find something that gives 0 as a result. Just by counting, you can show that a collision is guaranteed to exist. So can you find a collision to this function without writing a computer program? So when I wrote the paper, I couldn't find a collision to this function. But I couldn't prove that the function was collision resistant. So in the paper, I said that, I can prove it's one way. So it's a one-way function, collision resistant, open problem. In 2007, collisions were found independently, simultaneously by Vadim Lubashensky, my student at the time, and I, and Alon Rosen and Chris Peikert in parallel. They can be found as follows. So multiply these blocks by 1, 1, 1, 1, by the all one vector. And since these matrices are circulant, these products will give constant vectors. Here all the coordinates will be equal to 6. Here they will all be equal to 9. It's just the sum of the entries of the vectors. This reduces the collision finding problem to a one-dimensional problem. Now, can you find a 0, 1, minus 1 combination of these four integers that add up to 0? 6 plus 3 equals 9. So you find it very easily. And this gives a collision to the original function. So the function is not collision resistant. It is very easy to find the collisions. And the fact that collisions are easy to find is closely related to the fact that the circular matrices correspond to polynomial arithmetics modulo x to the n minus 1, So this is commonly used in the theory of cyclic codes, encoding theory. And this polynomial factors. It has a linear factor. And this linear factor is exactly what brings this down to a one-dimensional problem. So for this, so it is still one way. I could prove it is one way. There is some hardness, but it is not collision resistant. And so this can be fixed by using a similar type of structure. For example, if the dimension is a power of 2, you can take negacyclic matrices where when you perform rotations, you change the sign of the entry that goes around. And these correspond to working modulo x to the n plus 1 rather than x to the n minus 1, which when n is a power of 2 is an irreducible polynomial. So it doesn't have small factors. And not only it breaks the previous attack, but it also allows you to prove hardness. It is possible to show that if you can find collisions to this function, then you can solve worst-case lattice problems in a corresponding class of lattices that have this same type of structure. So there is some restriction on the type of lattices, but it is still a worst-case to average-case connection.
It was also discovered independently?
Sorry?
It was also discovered independently?
So this is from my work with Vadim, the negacyclic structure. What Chris and Alon did was to work with in lattices that have a prime dimension. So if you take x to the p minus 1, it factors x minus 1 times x to the p minus 1, xp minus 2, all the way to down to x plus 1. So Chris and Alon suggested to solve the problem using this structure. I think we mentioned both of them, and then we focus on the power of 2, which is also much easier to implement. And this and now these are the lattices that are most commonly used in lattice cryptography, also in the LWE setting. So most of the implementations of lattice cryptography uses now these negacyclic lattices that were introduced to address the collision resistance problem there. Then together, LM and PR, we wrote together a paper where we implemented this function, showing that you can even implement it and run it with a very fast implementation running in just a handful of microseconds, milliseconds. I don't remember the exact number, but was a speed comparable to block cipher type of hash functions, like SHA-1 type of functions, which for lattice constructions, for constructions based on mathematics, was something that was much, much faster than, say, factoring-based hash functions. And okay, so let me jump to the cryptographic applications. Okay, so 10 minutes, so there are, 3 minutes per application. Okay, so what I want to do is to show how this SIS function has some very interesting, useful properties, and each property can be used to build interesting, useful applications that go beyond a simple one-way function. Properties are compression, regularity, the fact that the function is kind of linear, and I'll show you how to build the collision resistant hashing, commitment schemes, and digital signatures. Don't worry, each one of these is a single slide, so it's not that, there's a property and then the construction. So compression, this function is proved one way using a setting where the domain is larger than the range. So we know that it is compressing the input. So you start from m bits, and you get something that is n log q bits, which is smaller than m. So typically, you make it twice as large, so it is compressing the bit size of the input by a factor 2. So good. We have a function which is compressing the input. So this is very useful in many applications in cryptography. So this is a hash function. If collisions were hard to find, so this can be used, for example, to build Merkle trees. You can take a large data set and then using this function to compress it 2 blocks at a time, you can compute a single value digest that somehow captures the entire big original data set. And then you can reveal the value of a leaf just revealing the values along a path in this tree. So these are called Merkle trees, is one of the most useful and widely used constructions in cryptography. You don't need lattices to do that. But can you do it using lattices and say that, oh, breaking this is as hard as solving lattice problems in the worst case? Now, this can be done using SIS. I already suggested that, oh, it's already collision resistant to start with. But it is also possible to show that you can go from one wayness to collision resistance in a black box way. So if this function is one way, then 0,1 is collision resistant. So assume that you can find a collision to function A down, we want to invert the function. We want to find a preimage. And notice we want a preimage of some value y. So a preimage of 0 would be easy to find. Those would be the collisions. But now we are also given, we don't want to get 0 as a result. We are given a value y, and we ask, oh, can you find something that maps to it? What we can do is just to add the target value to one of the columns of the matrix. The matrix is random. So perturbing one column still gives the uniform distribution. And when you multiply it by your collision, if so the collision are two different binary vectors, x and x prime. If one of these coordinates is 1 and the other one is 0, then you can bring the y to the other side and get a preimage of y. It's just a linear manipulation that allows to show that you are achieving collision resistance. So property number 2, regularity. So since we are above the smoothing parameter of the lattice, since the output is big, the input is bigger than the covering radius, we know that the output, the function is surjective, and not only that, it is also mapping the input to an almost uniform distribution. And this follows from a pairwise independent argument. So if you fix two different inputs, x1 and x2, not random, fix any two vectors, x1 and x2, if you pick the function a at random, these two outputs are statistically independent. So if I give you one value, if I only give you two values, I give you one, and then I ask you, oh, can you compute the function on the other value without knowing what A is? You don't know what that value is. It is hidden in an information theoretic sense. So it follows from pairwise independence that, independence together with compression implies regularity. So it's the standard result independent of lattices that the output is guaranteed to be very close to uniform. So what is good for? So just take this property so that you can go back, look at the slides, and look up the leftover hash lemma later if you like. But if why is this useful, this regularity property useful? It's not just nice. Because you can build it, we can use it to build commitment schemes. Now, a commitment scheme is a method to take a message and lock it in a box in such a way that the box does not reveal any information about the message, but still it protects the message. The message cannot be changed. It is locked in the box. So it is like an encryption scheme, but without decryption key. So without a method to encrypt and decrypt. So formally, a commitment scheme is a randomized function that takes a message together with some randomness. A commitment the output of the function is called a commitment to the message M, which is obtained by computing the function on the message and on a randomly chosen value r. And how do you open the box? You reveal which r was used to compute the commitment. So that's what you do in order to open the box. So what do we want from this function? We want it to be hiding. We want that the output of the function, when r is chosen properly at random, should not depend on M, should be completely independent. The output should have no connection to M. Because this value was chosen at random, and this randomizes also the output. So the box is black, so you cannot see inside. On the other hand, you don't want to be able to open it in two different ways. So it shouldn't be possible for an adversary to come up with two different openings, two different values of the randomness, or even the same one, where the same one wouldn't work, that open to the same commitment, so they result in the same box, but they reveal two different messages. So this should be hard. It shouldn't be possible to do that. So how can we build this type of function from SIS? Well, we can take not one, but two SIS matrices. And just to anticipate Vinod's question, the dimension of the matrices doesn't have to be the same. I'm just fixing the matrices to have the same dimension just for simplicity, so I have only one letter on the slide. Let me finish. Okay, so and then just put these two matrices one next to the other. Think of them as a larger SIS matrix. And so this is the function. It's the usual matrix vector multiplication, but what you get as a result is A1 times M plus A2 times R. And I claim that this is a good commitment scheme. So why so? Well, it is hiding, because even if you just look at the second part, we know it is close to a uniformly random vector. So it will completely hide what was added to it. So the output distribution, even for fixed M, is completely random. So this is the hiding property, so hiding commitment. So can you open the commitment in two different ways? Well, that's also hard, and this time it is computationally hard. Finding two different openings is exactly the problem of finding a collision to this SIS problem with a larger number of columns. So our proof average case worst case connection was working. You could pick as many columns as you want. So yeah, it is still a good distance of SIS, and it is collision resistant. So this gives another interesting application. So 1 minute left, one application left. So this function f is also homomorphic, linearly homomorphic. It's a linear function. So if you apply the function on the sum of two values, x1 and x2, you get the sum of the two outputs. So it's not exactly a homomorphism because the domain is not closed under addition. It is a sort of, it is an approximate closure property. The sum of short vectors is still a short vector, but a slightly longer one. But still, it is useful. So you can perform a bounded number of additions and still get the short vectors. So what is this? So this property is trivial to show, and there is also a corresponding property showing that it is linear in the keys, which is also useful in some applications. So if you apply two different functions on the same input, you can add up the keys together. So we not made the use of a key homomorphism of lattice functions in many interesting fancy lattice cryptographic applications. And here I will use it for a very simple application, which is that of one-time signatures. That is, digital signature schemes that allow to sign one message. I mean, you can sign more, but if you do, then it may not be secure. So show security only if you sign one. So in a signature scheme, there is a key generation algorithm that produces a public key and a secret key. The secret key is used to produce a digital signature of a message. It's a function that, given the key and the message, produces some kind of cryptographic value, which can be verified using a corresponding verification algorithm, which will accept the signature as good or not. So when is a scheme secure? If an adversary, which is given the public key, then it chooses a message and asks you, please, can you sign this message? And it is given this signature, because this scheme is used once by the honest user on an adversarially chosen message. And after seeing this signature, the adversary can come up with a forgery. It can come up with a signature of a different message. So this is an attack, so this should be hard. So if the adversary does this, then either the signature is not good, the verification algorithm fails, or it is the same as the original message, so it's not really a forgery, it's just the signature that was produced by the legitimate user. Otherwise, so this is a win for the adversary. So we want to build a cryptographic scheme that has these properties, and we want to build it out of SIS. General signature schemes are similar, but the adversary is allowed to make multiple queries. He can ask for signatures of arbitrarily many messages. So what do we do? We do the following. So the key to the one-time signature scheme will be a matrix consisting of short vectors. The public key is the hash of the secret key. You just multiply the secret key by A, and that's the public key. So how do we use this? We can take a message M, and we define a signature of M as a linear combination of the secret key. So we have our secret key X here. So I'm dividing into two parts, big X and small x. Big X is a matrix, small x is a vector. You can combine all of it in a single matrix if you like. And a signature is a linear combination of the columns of the secret key, where the coefficients of the secret combination depend on the message M. And I call this a signature. And notice you can use the linearity property to verify these signatures. If you apply the transformation A to the signature, this is A times XM plus X. By linearity, this can also be expressed as a linear combination of the public keys. So the verification algorithm takes the signature, takes the message, takes the public key, and checks that the secret key, the signature, hashes to a good combination of the public key. So this for verification. What about security? Oh, you can also make this more efficient using cyclic lattices, but let me skip the cyclic lattices details. So this is what we did. So our focus in the paper was to get efficient construction. So using so the main claim was about, oh, you can do this very efficiently. So why is this secure? Because if the adversary comes up with a forgery, which is the signature which hashes to this value, we can also use the secret key to come up with our own signature of the same message. And you can show that with high probability, these two signatures will be different. So there is no way for the adversary to guess which would be the signature that I would produce using my secret key. So if the adversary can produce a signature, then you have two signatures hashing to the same value, which is a collision to the SIS function, which we know is hard on average problem. Okay, so this concludes a brief sketch of the type of cryptographic applications you can build from SIS. You will see many more applications from LWE starting today, tomorrow. We know that we'll talk about Today is Chris about the theory of LWE, the harness of LWE, and then tomorrow we'll go into applications of LWE. But this is a brief, appetizer about just using the simpler SIS problem of why SIS is hard and why it is useful in cryptography.
Going once. Okay. Twice. Is either everyone is hungry or everyone understood everything, or both?